This is The Blackprint, where being black is always the topic of conversation. The Blackprint is brought to you by Rhymes and Designs and Good Evil Art. Welcome back to The Blackprint. It's your host, MJ. I would like to thank Art for handling the last two segments on Wall Street and its impact in the black community. He did a great job, and the segments were very engaging and informative. I'm back as the regular host, but we hope to have Art back as co-host or even the main host for other segments, and even to bring in additional people to speak. So if you have any suggested speakers, please let us know. Today I'm going to be talking about something that's deeply personal to me and a very important part of my journey. The natural hair movement, which reemerged in the 90s, has really become more than just a movement at this point. It's a way of life. This new wave has been around for over 20 years, and it's at the point where people are raising generations of children to love and appreciate their natural hair and to explore natural hairstyles and even the meaning and the history behind being natural and why for a long time a lot of people weren't natural. You see people from all different backgrounds, all different areas of the world, even different generations, people who are returning to their natural texture of hair. You see this whole big consumer base and this consumerism campaigns that are all about natural hair. Look at all the natural hair products, the natural hair patents, the festivals and the expos and the YouTube channels, and there's so much these days is dedicated to our natural hair. And to me, it's a beautiful thing. It's a wonderful thing. So I just wanted to talk about what got me to this place where I decided to embrace my natural hair and what has kept me going and kept me learning and loving my hair and understanding my history and my culture and my rich, vibrant heritage. And also just to talk about my journey. My mom started processing my hair when I was pretty young. So young that I didn't even know what my hair texture was until I decided to go natural when I was 18. I actually decided on my 18th birthday that I was going to do it. I was not going to process my hair anymore. As a child, that's just what you did with your hair. You got a perm, you know? And the only people that didn't get perms were people who had these looser textures of hair because there was the concern that the chemicals would be too strong for their hair and it would burn their hair off. What was really positive about my experience, even though my hair was being processed, was that I didn't possess a lot of hair hate. My mom didn't teach me to hate my hair or to hate my natural texture. I never thought or was taught to see a perm as changing my bad texture into a better texture. I always thought of processing my hair as being a way to make it more manageable. I didn't know what it was moving from because my hair had, from when I was a small child all the way through my teenage years, I was consistently getting perms, and I never really gotten to see my hair texture or to know what it was like. But my mom didn't teach me that I got my hair permed because my hair was bad. You know, there was the conversation of good hair and bad hair, which is not something my mom really perpetuated. My sister, she had looser curls, and they are thought to be very beautiful, but we had different hair, and I was never told that my hair was ugly or anything. And with my mom raising four children by herself, I understood the need to be able to manage your child's hair, because my mom had three daughters and a son, So she didn't have a significant amount of time to manage every single head in the house and raise her four children. And so I understood it as a way to, you know, maximize time. Not that my hair was bad. So I think that definitely made the journey a lot easier for me. I also had positive feelings about my hair. For one, my hair was fine, which I didn't understand would be a potential issue once I went natural having fine hair. But because it was fine, it was more manageable, which made me happy because I felt like my hair was less of a burden on my mother. And also, I had some red streaks in my hair, which made me feel special because my deceased grandmother, she actually passed away when my mom was 7. She had red hair. And so I felt closer to my grandmother because I had those red streaks. So I never disliked my hair. And even though it was processed, it grew to be long and it was healthy. And in the Black community, and maybe other communities, but I wouldn't know, there's a sense of pride associated with our hair. And because my hair was, it looked nice, it was healthy, it was long. Like, I didn't have bad feelings about my hair. That's not what motivated me personally to go natural at all. As time went on, I took more and more responsibility over the care of my hair. You know, I washed it, I conditioned it, I detangled it. I learned to trim it. And at some point, I even learned to perm my own hair. And so some of these practices included, you know, nightly brushing, and I stopped using synthetic hair in my hair, like if I were to get my hair braided or something. I stopped using gel in my hair because it broke my hair off and it just made it shorter and way less healthy. In my teenage years, I had taken full responsibility over my hair, and I was looking into, you know, processing what that the process meant, what the chemicals were. I was reading the instructions and figuring out how to make my hair as healthy as it could be. And so I saw something about perming your hair every 6 weeks and then perming your hair every 8 weeks. And so I decided in my mind that I would perm my hair every 12 weeks. I would perm my hair every 3 months or 4 times a year. I thought that that would protect the hair that had already been processed, because I learned that reprocessing your hair would overprocess your hair and damage your hair. So I thought that if I let the hair grow longer, there would be a lower chance of me damaging the hair that had already been processed. But in this time, you know, you have a lot of what we used to call new growth. In 3 months, your hair grows so much. So I was perming my hair every 3 months, and I found myself playing in my roots and my new growth a lot. And I just always had my fingers in there. I always had my fingers near my scalp, feeling my hair, feeling this texture that I was completely unaccustomed to feeling, that I was completely unacquainted with, and I liked it. I liked my roots. I liked my natural hair that grew out of my scalp. And so one day I decided I was gonna cut off the processed hair and I wasn't gonna perm my hair anymore. I remember telling some of my classmates that one day I was gonna wear my hair in twists. I wasn't gonna have to do anything to the ends of my hair, and it was gonna stay twisted. When I decided to go natural, I didn't have really any examples. I didn't have any YouTubers to look up to. I didn't have any magazines. I didn't even know what going natural meant. I just knew that I was gonna stop processing my hair. And so from January to August, I let my natural hair grow out because I wanted it to be long. If I'm going to cut it all off and if I'm going to stop perming it, I at least wanted to have some hair. Like, having hair, having long hair was always something that was important. So I decided to let it grow those 8 months. And when I was getting ready to go to college, my mom was like, look, if you're going to stop perming your hair, then you need to cut the processed hair off. You need to get rid of it because it doesn't look good. And so I went upstairs and I washed my hair and I saw where it curled and where it was straight. And I put it in some braids and I took some scissors and I cut it off. That was my big chop. I didn't know it was called a big chop. That was something that came after I went natural. This was in 2009. So it was a long time ago for a lot of people. It was before the natural movement had arrived at their doorsteps. You know, it was still something that just a few people were doing. I didn't even know about the term going natural until March or April when I went to go visit the university that I would eventually go to. And the young woman hosting me, a young woman from Detroit, saw my hair because I had straightened it out for the Black Student Weekend, which I was attending, and it was hot, and my hair started to poof up a little bit, and she was like, oh, so you're going natural, and I looked at her with, like, a blank face because I didn't know what she was talking about. You know, I was putting two together, like, I think she's talking about my hair. And I was like, sure, yeah, I'm going natural. I had never heard that before. That was the first time I had ever heard that phrase, going natural. And she was aware of this transition from having processed hair to going back to your natural texture, because she had spent her entire life natural, just pressing her hair out, until at some point in her teenage years she had decided that she was going to perm her hair, and she thought that her hair looked better and it was a lot healthier, a lot thicker in its natural state. So she transitioned back from processing to natural. So she had a full life understanding of her natural hair, and so she had the language, she had the terminology for it. But that was the first time, the March of 2009, that I'd ever heard the phrase going natural. So as you can imagine, going natural for me was kind of a rough process. I didn't really know what tools to use. I didn't really know what products worked for me. I didn't really even know what kind of products people who are natural use, and that those products were different than the products that people use when they process their hair. And so I decided to figure this all out freshman year of college. What was really great was that while the natural hair movement hadn't hit Michigan, it had touched a lot of places, especially college campuses. So I had friends that were either going natural, interested in going natural, or just interested in the natural hair movement. And they helped me out a lot. They told me to tuck my straight pieces when I wore my afro, which, you know, I didn't know because I just did a rough chop on my hair. They taught me things about, you know, wrapping your hair and, like, ways you can get styles like twist outs and braid outs. And so that was really great. It was really great. There's a lot of Black women on campus who were supportive of the natural hair movement, even if they hadn't decided to enter into the community just yet. Also, something that was, I think, really helped make my transition easier was that I moved from the Midwest to the South. And though a lot of people in the South at that point weren't wearing their hair in afros, a lot of people had been natural their entire lives and they had simply pressed their hair. So I feel like people in the South embrace natural hair in a different way, and I feel like quicker than other communities, because to some extent, a lot of people were used to natural hair. I mean, even if you press your hair all the time, when you wash it, it does poof back up. And I was just so amazed by the reception when I went natural. A lot of young Black men were like, ooh, I love your hair. You know, I love natural hair. So many Black women wanted to ask me questions, and they gave a lot of, you know, positive commentary about my natural hair, and they just made me feel like my natural hair was beautiful and that there was something empowering about seeing a Black woman walking around with her natural hair texture. And I was the type of person with my natural hair, I always like to wear it big. You know, like I told you in the beginning of the segment, I have fine hair. So it definitely benefits me to have kinky, coarse hair, kinky, coily, coarse hair, because it gives me so much volume. So I'm the type of person where I wear an afro, I wear an afro puff, I wear twist outs, I wear braid outs. I like to have big hair. I like to have a lot of volume. And that's how I walked around, you know, 9 times out of 10. 90% of the time I was wearing big hair. And so it just, I don't know, it was this constant visual reminder that just made, I feel like the people around me feel more connected to our hair and more connected to our roots and proud of who we are and who we were. And so it was a good experience. You know, in college, you had the couple of people who wanted to make negative comments. Not that too many people make negative comments to my face, but a couple of times I did hear, like, guys say things like, oh, you know, I don't usually like natural hair, but I like it on you, which is obviously not a compliment. And it's like, how do you dislike natural hair? I could see you not understanding it and being, you know, surprised and being like, okay, this is something new. But to say you don't like natural hair, and to a black woman with natural hair, is pretty obtuse, you know. But it was a positive experience. It actually took my family longer to get used to my natural hair, because it was just something that people were not doing in the Midwest. But then I feel like at that, around that same time, I decided to become a pescatarian, which means I only eat seafood. I don't eat beef and chicken and pork and turkey. And so they were like, oh, like you went to college and you became this whole new person. Even though I've kind of always been that person, I make up my mind and I just will change something, even if it's drastic. That's just who I am. But, you know, they didn't discourage me. My mom was mostly like, you know, if you're going to be natural, you should make sure your hair looks cute. You know what I'm saying? Like, you need to get these products. You need to do these things. But one of the most amazing things about going natural, for me personally, was that, you know, I didn't know my hair. And once I started making that transition, I realized that by not knowing my hair, I didn't really know myself. And I've always been taught to be pro-black. I've always loved being black. You know, I've always had so much appreciation for the contributions and the sacrifices of my ancestors, always. But I didn't realize that by rejecting my natural hair, I felt like I was rejecting myself. And so after going natural, I feel like I know myself so much better. And I have, like, some people say they have a love-hate relationship with their hair. I don't have a love-hate relationship with my hair. I have a love relationship with my hair. It's new and it's different, and some days it's this and some days it's that, and sometimes these products work, and it's always encouraging me to get to know myself better. And it is a lot of work sometimes, but then I just look at how beautiful it is and I feel it and I touch it, and I know that it's worth the work. Anything in life that's worth having is worth working for, right? So one of the things about going natural that has been the most inspiring to me is how it's affected the people around me. A lot of people were skeptical, and we had conversations, and they saw my growth and my journey, and their minds became more open. Both of my sisters are natural. I remember one summer my brother coming to me and saying, you know what? Perms are really, really bad for you. They're these toxic chemicals and they do these things to your scalp. It's like he had decided in his mind to go and do some research, to go and look it up, and to say that black women should not be perming their hair anymore because it's not good for their health and that everyone should go natural. That was my brother, who, when I decided to go natural, would always see me and sing the Soul Glow song from Coming to America. So many of my friends have gone natural. I've had colleagues go natural, and I've just seen how it has transformed their life. And I feel like they love themselves more and they're more confident in themselves. And I feel like the disconnect between black men and black women, natural hair has built something of a bridge. Because it's like when you walk in your glory, There's no one that can deny that. And I think the black men with natural hair, you know, didn't even know what they were missing until they started seeing it and on a regular basis and seeing the glow and the confidence of, you know, black women rocking their natural hair. And now even black men, look at the NBA, look at the NCAA. So many of those young black men, they have natural hairstyles themselves. You know what I'm saying? And that's why I feel like it's not a movement anymore. It hasn't taken over our entire community. It's definitely a part of the culture. And I don't think it's a coincidence that the natural hair movement has coincided with this push, this realization, well, this re-realization that we are great as a people. We are amazing. We are capable of so many wonderful and amazing things. I mean, really anything that we set our mind to. I don't think it's a coincidence that those two movements have coincided with one another. I truly think that this is not a trend, that no matter how the government, our societies try to oppress us, try to repress this connection to self, I truly believe that no matter how much they try to do that, that we're not going to go back. There might be some regression. We already see some of that with the texture discrimination or how YouTubers or whatever that are mixed or lighter complected are more likely to get views. So we already see some regression, but this is the future. And I think we're only going to fall more and more in love with ourselves as time goes by. And I think it is the fear of those who want to oppress us that as we love ourselves more, we will demand more and we will stand for less of their BS. I'm going to end this segment with a song from Bengy Cinco featuring Rome DiCarlo, called Natural Curly Hair.
Do I love you? Do I lust for you? Am I a sinner because I do the two? Can you let me know right now, please? The needle at the bone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ayo, that natural curly hair make me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. And natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Like
5'5" brown eyes, natural hair, honey blonde tips, naps everywhere. Body so amazing, can't help but stare. I wanna get to know, we can be a perfect pair. Sweeter than some Kool-Aid, yeah, you know the red kind. One in a million, you know she the red kind. Classic soul like Reeboks and Tim Boots. Brown skin popping and you think like them roots. 21 and no kids, single like a dollar in your hand of your biz. Style like hip hop and J's on your feet. You the kind of woman that I've been waiting to meet. I saw you at my last show wearing a pink shirt. Still right beside me, but you ain't wanna speak first. I told Rome to call her if it's meant for us to meet. Then I'll see you again, so I hope that I can see you.
Hey, yo, that natural curly hair make me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Natural curly hair make me stop and stare. And that's your curly hair, girl, it make me stop and stare. Like
dressed on your back, caramel, pretty features. I like your open-toed or your untied sneakers. Pedicure feet, strong Christ believer. Dick like grits, tatted sweeter than a peacher. Class like a high school, baby girl, you're so cool. I like your tattoos, like your skin so smooth. Looking like justice, I hope you like old school. If not, I got some other things I can show you. Young, but you're so mature. Only catch feelings for a man, not a boy. Saw you at Boston's just before. You put flames on the stage, my jaw hit the floor. So I approach you like, what's up, I'm Cinco. Your voice super dope and I'm digging your stilo. Find it in the parking ticket, girl, you're so mean. And your natural curly hair really does something to me. No diss to the women that still rock your tracks though. just gotta let you know that I'm down with the naps.
Ayo, that natural curly hair made me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare. Natural curly hair made me stop and stare. That natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare. Natural curly hair made me stop and stare. Natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare. Natural curly hair made me stop and stare. And natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare. Like. Hey yo, that natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare like. Hey yo, that natural curly hair, girl, it made me stop and stare like.
So that was Natural Curly Hair by Bengy Cinco featuring Rome DiCarlo. Please remember to subscribe to our channel and to like and share this video. Also, if you have any comments, go ahead and leave those comments in the comment section. That was the Blackprint, and this is MJ, sending you love, peace, and ammunition.